Hello, everybody. This is Moscow Mailbag coming round again. Today, your mailbag team is Doris Maxima, back from her holidays, and myself, Edward Diablov. Yes, Tom's gone on his holidays, and as I said, here's Doris back from hers, and looking very fit, I must say.
And I feel fit. The first thing I did on getting back was to fish out my umbrella. When I was on a Baltic cruise, it was sizzling hot, and everyone was saying, when's it going to rain? Well, here, when I got back, everyone was saying, rain, rain, go away, come back on another day. But more about my holiday next week, when I've had time to get dug in and have read some of your letters. Well, who's our first letter from today, Edward?
An old friend of yours, Doris, Brian Hartley of Thornton-le-Field, asking what's being done to build up Anglo-Soviet relations.
A great deal's being done, Brian. Hello, Brian. It's nice to be talking to you again. And to find that this week, the first batch of letters that I started on, there was one from you. Thank you very much indeed for writing. And now for your question, Brian. You know, I think it would be no exaggeration to speak of a new stage in the development of Soviet-British relations. Very pleasant indeed. For one thing, it's been marked by a series of visits back and forth. It started after Harold Wilson's visit to Moscow in February of last year for talks with Leonid Brezhnev, the Soviet Communist Party's General Secretary. And after that, there was a marked increase in business, in trade and cultural contacts. And then, not very long ago, the Soviet Foreign Minister Andrei Gromyko visited Britain. And in talks with Mr. Callaghan, Brezhnev not only spoke about further development of trade, but of scientific and cultural contacts and economic cooperation. And they also stressed the need for broader political cooperation. And then, another important step, there was the visit to Britain this past spring of Vladimir Kirilin. Now, Vladimir Kirilin is vice chairman of the Council of Ministers, and he's chairman of the State Committee for Science and Technique. Now, he came for the fifth session of the British-Soviet Committee for Scientific and Technical Cooperation. And there was a good deal of discussion on trade, too.
By the way, one of our own listeners, Thomas Flannelly of Armstow, asks about that.
I know you've got some figures there, Eddie. I'm giving the game away, but perhaps you take over.
Well, at this session it was noted that the trade volume between our countries rose in the period from 1974 to 1975 from 890 million rubles to 959 million. And the doubling of British exports in that period was naturally satisfactory to the British side. At present, the USSR has placed a number of widely varied orders in Britain, and an important point is that many of them are very big. There are whole factories, like for instance a factory for making razor blades, which recently started work in Leningrad, a chemical works, and so on. The veteran of these British-built factories is the automobile tire factory in Dnipropetrovsk, and by a happy chance its output bears the same letter as trademark D for Dunlop, and also for Dnipropetrovsk. The development plans in this country are so wide that cooperation with the other countries are included.
Yes, I heard about Wilkinson Swords building that factory. In other words, the principle of international division of labor.
Exactly, yes. And to follow this, to encourage trade, international exhibitions are regularly held in this country. And, of course, British firms take part. And everybody exhibiting, all trade, scientific and technical delegations from Britain, have remarked that opportunities for cooperation are better than they have ever been.
And changes for the better in Anglo-Soviet relations and advances in détente all over the world can only help forward cooperation, which is, after all, in the interests of both countries. Well, I think that's about all on that question. What's the next one?
It's from Mr. S.B. Mattison of Blackburn, and he's interested in tourism possibilities in the Soviet Union.
Oh, tourism. There are no end of possibilities. Tourism for people in other countries, arranged by the big Soviet in-tourist firm, offers routes that take in over 100 towns, widely varied routes which would hold enough interest to satisfy any taste. This is a big country, as you know, with many nationalities and many ancient cultures. For instance, there are museum towns, or what we call museum towns, Novgorod, Suzdal, Vladimir, or Rostov the Great. These are a part with very, very old traditions of settled habitation and culture. In these towns, one can see most interesting architecture, frescoes and icons by the great old masters who carried on the Byzantine traditions. Then in the Carpathians, a lovely part of the country in the West Ukraine, where there are fantastic forests and there are also fantastic wooden churches. And by the way, they remind me of Chinese pagodas. And the traditional folk art there is, well, it's wonderful, really marvelous embroidery. You simply wonder how they find the time to do it. It must take an awful lot of time. In the Caucasus, there are buildings dating back, well, thousands of years. There are famous centers of handicrafts. And for the one who really likes winemaking, there are excellent local wines. And there's the local cooking, which really is something. Although it's true, they do bear down rather heavily on the spices, especially pepper. Then if you go further east, there's Central Asia, with the fantastic capitals of medieval Muslim emirates, the Samarkand, built by Tamerlane and Bukhara and Khiva.
Yes, the very names sound fascinating.
Yes, don't they?
But these are the traditional tourist excursions. Many people want to see more of life as it's lived today, and in-tourist caters for that.
Huh.
With visits to factories, schools, collective farms, kindergartens and so on, and brings visitors together with the ordinary man in the street. In the coming 5 years, tourist exchanges with other countries are expected to double. Their increase is included in agreements on economic and cultural cooperation with Britain, France, Federal Germany, the United States, and quite a number of other countries.
Of course, I need hardly say that you should give a good deal of thought to your route, especially on a first visit. If you want long trips to exciting places, and if you've got the money, of course, you can fly to Siberia to see Lake Baikal, and it really is worth seeing. Or if you're technically minded, you can go to the Bratsk hydroelectric station, one of the world's biggest.
And don't forget winter sport. If that interests you, there are some fine alpine resorts in the Caucasus.
Or if you just want to rest and take it easy in lovely surroundings, there is the Black Sea coast, the Soviet Riviera. And if you're off color and need a bit of treatment, the North Caucasus has the world's biggest collection of mineral springs, the spas.
And a few more in other places too, but some people don't have all that much time, and for them, there are short tours, taking in just Moscow and Leningrad.
And there's plenty to see there, too. Don't forget that. I'll only mention the Hermitage Art Museum in Leningrad. I mean, you could spend any amount of time there. As a matter of fact, some people come back twice, especially to see the Hermitage Museum. Its collection has probably only four or five anywhere to equal it.
And now what about our music request, Doris?
Well, what is it? I mean, you've got the letter. I've only just come back.
You know, it's from Mr. Ted Mulligan of London. He's written just after a visit to this country, the fourth, as a matter of fact.
You seem to have found it interesting, Mr. Mulligan. And I see that you know a bit of Russian, too. Well, so you took in Armenia, and now you'd like to hear some Armenian folk music. Well, I don't know if this particular piece was among the music you heard. If it is, it'll bring back some happy memories.
Thank you.
that Armenian music for Mr. Ted Mulligan of London, who's just returned from a very pleasant visit to Armenia. Next is a letter from Leo Desmond of Guildford, Essex. He wants to know about the ginseng plant. Well, I'll ask our science correspondent, Boris Belitsky, about that. Boris, what exactly is the ginseng plant? I haven't actually seen the root. It's something like a parsnip, I believe, only a doubled root.
Yes,
it's a medicinal plant, isn't it?
Yes. You see, no other plant has probably been the subject of so many legends, and certainly none is valued as highly.
It's usually a very small plant, though, isn't it?
Yes, forked-looking, and with scarlet berries when in bloom. The biggest wild ginseng plant ever found in this country, it weighed just under 14 pounds. And that was in 1905. It was sold in Shanghai afterwards for $5,000. No bigger wild plant has ever been found in the world, but a plant grown on a plantation in the Soviet Far East weighed 25 pounds. In fact, a pound of ginseng nets the plantation 215 rubles, That's just under £100 sterling.
But tell me, why is it that it's so frightfully expensive?
Well, its medicinal reputation is nearly 5,000 years old. And scientists are still finding that it has new curative properties of which no one dreamed. That's why it's literally worth its weight in gold.
Where is the wild ginseng plant found in the Soviet Union, Boris?
Mostly in the Ossuri Taiga in the Far East. In a single year, the herb collectors have brought in about £550 or so. One of their greatest ambitions is to find the great lost plantation of ginseng presented to the Russian explorer Vladimir Arsenyev at the beginning of the century by his local guide and friend, Dersu Uzala. There are now many clues as to the whereabouts of this lost plantation, which could now possibly be enormous.
My, what a treasure hunt. Well, thank you very much indeed for coming along, Boris Belitsky.
A few minutes ago, we spoke about the Alpine winter sport resorts in the Caucasus. Now we've got a listener and old friend, John Singleton of Ashby de la Zouch, who wonders, what do we play in summer in the way of sport?
Well, I'd say the recent Montreal Olympics were rather eloquent about that. The Soviet teams were in almost all the events.
All but field hockey, and that was because it's been taken up here only recently. The most popular games here, of course, are football and volleyball, played everywhere. Then there are track and field sports, cycling, rowing, and these make up part of what isn't usually included in sport. Hiking, touring in all its many forms.
Well, from what I've seen about Moscow, I'd say that on fine weekends, the entire youthful population goes out camping.
But there's a point here that's rather interesting. In the summer, there are winter sports too. Remember the size and variety of this country. There's the Caucasus. People are going there now in summer for a bit of skiing. And right here in Moscow, if you happen to be near Lenin Hills, where the ski jump is, you can see skiers soaring through the air.
Yes, it really is rather startling if you don't know that the run is covered with special material so that people can train all the year round.
But to come back to the more traditional summer sports, a little while ago, a rowing canal was opened in Moscow. One can row now in 10 places or so in Moscow itself, or close by. Then there's a riding school in the big Moscow Sokolniki Park. And as for cycling, there's been a special 12-kilometer cycling ring near Moscow for a long time. And finally, the great stadium at Luzhniki, the country's biggest, has a number of tennis courts, a big swimming pool, or rather pools, football grounds and areas laid out for various games.
But we seem to be talking mainly about Moscow, Eddie, and although sports grounds here are bigger, and there are more of them than in the smaller towns, other places are well provided for too, aren't they?
Of course they are, according to their size and population, but as the capital of the country, Moscow naturally tops them. And now there'll be more facilities laid out for the Olympics being held in 4 years' time. And that isn't just a tribute to Soviet sport. It puts a big responsibility on us, to all those will be coming to take part in the 1980 Games.
And so here we are back where we started, the Olympics. The Montreal results certainly did demonstrate what we've been saying. Sport has massive facilities here and a massive popularity, which means there's plenty of choice for competitors. And as you know, the Soviet team took first place in the unofficial list, gaining the greatest number of medals.
I'd like once more to stress the point that people are keen on sport all over the country, and the Soviet team included people from all the 15 Soviet republics. And as Doris said, they offer a very wide choice. And now our last letter. It's from Adrian Knott of Wensbury in the Midlands. And being a schoolboy, Adrian is naturally interested in school life in this country, and also night school possibilities for people already working.
Well, first of all, Adrian, thanks very much for your letter, and we're glad you're such a regular mailbag listener. I hope you're listening now with the reception good. Now, about the schools. School begins for boys and girls at the age of seven or so. Seven, maybe, just over seven. It rather depends on when your birthday is. But most children already have a little introductory learning from nursery school. They're usually able to read, for instance. Of course, that's easier with Russian. The spelling is phonetic. You spell as you speak. A schooling lasts for 10 years. All schools all over the country follow the same program. So if you have to change schools, it's easy to slip into the routine. A school student completing the 10 forms, and practically all of them do, has the right to enter college or university. There are no A or O levels here. A Soviet teachers regarded as useless and altogether wrong to divide children into higher or lower categories. Instead, all are offered the same broad general teaching and a still broader choice of out-of-school activities. There are study circles arranged by the school for those interested in, say, radio. Then there are hobby groups run by children's clubs or by factories or scientific institutes. Boys of your age, for instance, can take up anything: radio, painting, botany, or space study. The group's activities are led by trained teachers. And every year, there are intergroup competitions on a republican, national, or international scale.
But we seem to have got away from the school itself. As we see it, the chief aim is to teach boys and girls to learn, to develop an inquiring mind.
Oh, I quite agree with you there. You see, Adrian, in our times of rapid advance along just about all lines of human endeavor, people have to go on learning all their lives. But to come down to details, at your age, Adrian, the school subjects would be language and literature, maths, physics and biology, history, and one foreign language, usually English, French or German. The program, of course, includes sport and games, and also some working skill, like carpentry, metalwork, or what would you. In the higher forms, the program becomes somewhat heavier.
The subject of schools, Mr. Calvert of London asks about the school leaving age. It's 17 or 18, and with the economic development going on here, all school leavers can either find a job without any difficulty, or go on to college or specialized school for training.
Yes, and that brings us to evening school for adults. These are usually evening technical colleges or university courses. All evening school students are guaranteed by law certain privileges at work. The most important being long vacations with pay at exam times and 4 months paid vacation to write the graduation work. The diploma they get on graduation differs in no way from the graduation diploma at a day college.
And one final point. There are no tuition fees either at school or at colleges and universities. All free. Well, and there we'll have to finish for today.
So it's bye-bye from me. See you soon.
The team on Moscow Mailbag today was Doris Maxina and me, Edward Diablov.